may be seated. Okay, let the record reflect that the defendant was present along with counsel for the defendant, Assistant State Attorney, Mr. Hyatt.
Your Honor, for the record, the defense will withdraw as previously filed.
Objecting to the location for the change of venue.
Okay. All right. I believe the next scheduled matter is the Anthony's motion to be excluded from the rule of sequestration. Pursuant to Gore versus State, you may proceed, sir.
Thank you, Judge. Mark Levin on behalf of George and Cindy Anthony. We previously filed a motion. In that motion, we cited several cases. There's a memorandum of law. I don't know if the court's had an opportunity to read it. But prior to getting into the meat of the motion, I'd ask that the court take judicial notice that both George and Cindy Anthony have been deposed in this case, and they've, to my understanding, I'll ask the state on the record, have you deposed George and Cindy Anthony?
The depositions have been filed, Your Honor. They've both been deposed.
And I'll ask the state, the defense on the record, have you had access to that deposition and you were part of that deposition?
Yes.
Judge, in addition to the motion we filed, I happen to find a case on point, and it's Beasley versus State, 774 Southern 2nd, 649. If I may approach.
You may, sir.
In addition to the other cases cited, and initially in our motion, we were relying on Booker v. State. We would actually change our position slightly and rely on Beasley versus State, which is more analogous to this case. In the Beasley case, there were two material witnesses that were requested not to be able to attend the trial based on the rule of sequestration. And I point the court to Headnote 14 and 15, where it said the sequestration rule did not apply to the murder victim's son and daughter on basis that the son and daughter were key state witnesses who might change their testimony to conform to evidence presented, where son and daughter's testimony was memorialized in prior depositions. Headnote 15 says, presence of victim's son and daughter in an emotionally charged courtroom during capital murder trial arising from victim's death by severe beating with hammer did not violate defendant's right to fair trial, where court maintained vigilance so that defendant would not be prejudiced by any emotional displays. And for the record, I'm handing this case also to the defense. Your Honor, essentially, our motion identifies that the court needs to, if there's an objection by the defense, identify three things. The first is, are George and Anthony and Cindy Anthony next of kin as defined by law? The second is that, is there a conflict between the rights of George Anthony and Cindy Anthony attending the trial under Article 1, Section 16B of the Florida Constitution?
Slow it down a little bit so the court reporter can
make sure
she takes it down.
Section 16B of the Florida Constitution and the rights of defendant Casey Anthony. And C, what is the prejudice to the defendant if George Anthony and Cindy Anthony attend the trial? With the first issue, are George Anthony and Cindy Anthony next of kin as defined by the law? Madam Court Reporter, if I do go too fast, just signal me. The Constitution does not necessarily identify next of kin, but Article 1, Section 16B says victims of crime or their lawful representatives, including the next of kin of homicide victims, are entitled to the right to be informed, to be present, and to be heard when relevant at all crucial stages of criminal proceedings to the extent that these rights do not interfere with the constitutional rights of the accused. Next of kin is not specifically identified, as I previously said, but the idea of the next of kin attending a court proceeding, according to Farina versus State, was prejudicial because the jurors and prospective jurors could see the families become emotional or embrace. However, victims do have a constitutional right to be present at court proceedings. The first prong of this test, as I identified, is whether or not George and Cindy Anthony are next of kin. In analyzing that, since there's no next of kin identified in the Florida Constitution, we would ask that under 90.616, Florida statutes or applicable case law, the expansive meaning of the term may be seen in former provisions of Florida law. For example, although the current statute regarding the preference, yes, ma'am, regarding the preference for the appointment of an administrator for the estate of a person dying intestate used their term heir nearest in degree. And that's pursuant to 733.301. The prior statute dealt with a situation where there were several next of kin equally near in degree. 732.802 Florida statute, and that was 1973. If next of kin only meant the heir nearest in degree, then there was no reason for the prior statute to speak of next of kin equally.
I don't think there's any argument that they're next of kin.
Yes, sir. And that was the point of the motion. There was no presentation that they're not next of kin by either the state or the defense.
Anybody object that they're next of kin? State, defense?
No, not the state.
Okay.
Then it goes to the second prong of the argument, Your Honor. Is there a conflict between the rights of George Anthony and Cindy Anthony attending the trial under Article 1, Section 16B of the Florida Constitution and the rights of Defendant Casey Anthony? And we would rely on the Beasley case presented to the court initially at the beginning of this hearing, that we hold that the Beasley case is what the court should follow, since it is very, very close in nature as to the idea that the two witnesses cited in that case were material witnesses, as George Anthony and Cindy Anthony have been identified, that they both were deposed, that their depositions memorialized their statements, that in this case the state and the defense have identified that the depositions occurred of those two people, that in this case their depositions memorialized their statements, and therefore, based on the Beasley case, they should have access and they should be allowed to be excluded from the rule of sequestration. So then that would lead to the final issue, which is prong C. What is the prejudice to the defendant if George Anthony and Cindy Anthony attend the trial? And at that case, and at that point, it's my position that the burden of proof has shifted because no evidence has been offered other than a motion filed yesterday by Mr. Mason on behalf of his client, indicating that they intend on calling my clients back as impeachment witnesses or to impeach them. Certainly they have that opportunity and the depositions are available for them to impeach them, but that in and of itself does not show prejudice pursuant to the Beasley case. And I understand that the court has discretion and has liberal discretion in allowing them, and in an abundance of caution I understand that the court can say that they're not, based on the court's previous ruling, that they would be testifying first before they would be allowed to sit in the courtroom for any other proceedings. However, based on the defense's motion at this point, the way the defense is portraying things, they may not be able to attend any portion of the trial other than closing arguments. And finally, Your Honor, at this point, the rule of sequestration has not been formalized by either the defense or state for the trial. So this issue, while we're arguing it, is certainly still not ripe yet until one or the other party actually invokes the rule. That's all I have, sir.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Mason?
Judge, indeed, we do not challenge, even though the absence of definition by statute, particularly the next of kin, there's a great deal of case law that says stepmothers, nieces, and nephews, and so forth, so we're past that. Having depositions is not the end of the day. As the court knows, in Crawford v. Washington, simply the fact that you took depositions or had access to doesn't mean you don't have entitlement to confront. George and Cindy Anthony are material witnesses in this case. They have been on the state's witness list from day one. George Anthony testified before the grand jury to render the indictment in this case, which transcript we have unsuccessfully sought to get, but we'll renew that at an additional time also. We have the right to have them to testify, to confront and cross-examine them without being distorted or contaminated by sitting in the courtroom. It's unfortunate, but this is an unusual case. In the case cited by counsel, we're talking about victims who are not material witnesses. Victims or next of kin defined victims who are not material witnesses, entirely different from this case. We have the right to recall George and Cindy Anthony, and we suspect they're likely to be recalled on more than one occasion in this case as it develops, based on what we do know. My client is adamant that she wants to be able to have their testimony accepted fully by the jury. If the jury is able to sit and observe them in the courtroom week after week, and then they're called to the witness stand, that discredits the value of their testimony as being objective and uncontaminated. We do not waver. We object to the rule of sequestration exempting them, and I will agree, it may be premature. It'll be the first thing we do when we get back here. So what's the mystery? Thank you.
Mr. Ashton?
Yes, Your Honor. The state of Florida has no objection to the Anthony's being excluded from the rule of sequestration if, in fact, and when it is invoked. The Anthony's have not only given very, very lengthy depositions, each of them have given at least three lengthy sworn statements by tape, and as everyone knows, numerous other statements to many other persons. The only thing we would request is we understand that the Anthony's, very understandable, are very emotional about this, and we share a concern about the jurors having a tendency to want to look at them during the trial to see their reaction. We're also concerned about that some members of the public have very strong reactions to them. So in the interest of both of those, we would ask that if they are allowed in the courtroom, that they sit in the balcony so that they will be separated from the general public, anyone who might have some want to take issue with them, and also they'll be somewhat more distant from the jury so that the jury will not be constantly looking to them for reactions that they may have. And just to clarify the record, our intention is to call the Anthony's more than once in our case in chief, so they will be testifying a number of times in the case.
Okay.
Response, Your Honor? Very brief. Directed to Mr. Mason's argument, sir. Certainly he's arguing the Gore case and the Booker case that I cited. He did not address the Beasley case, where in fact those two witnesses were material witnesses and they still were able to be excluded from the rule of sequestration. Thank you, sir.
One last question, Mr. Mason. Again, Mr. Mason, how would your client be prejudiced by the Anthony's being there?
By the practice of their testimony and cross-examination, by having seen the rest of the testimony of other witnesses, affects the impeachment. If we want to impeach them of what they've heard, it just takes away from being an objective witness. It's the reason why we have a rule of sequestration, so witnesses don't get to hear what other people are saying and therefore be able to mold their testimony based on what has been said. And now we know, indeed, that from the state, candidly, they intend to call the Anthony's on more than one occasion themselves, and we're likely to call them on more than one occasion, depending on how the case goes. There is no case similar to that.